There's something you should know about Linux. Not that it's an open source operating system, although that's true, nor that it can run on pretty much every computing platform, from PCs to smartphones to servers and mainframes, although it does. Now, what you need to know about Linux is that Linux administrators are clearly very busy people because everything in Linux takes a word that you already know, take distribution, for example, and it shortens it to a word you probably don't. How about we just call these things distros? Or take another word like repository. That's far too many syllables. Let's just go with repo. And look, Linux commands, they apparently suffer from a vowel shortage because ls, that means list stuff, mv, that means move. And directories, they're not much better. Slash mnt is apparently mount. And then slash usr, that's for Unix system resources, I think. But despite its quirks, Linux has become one of the most reliable, widely used operating systems on the planet, which is frankly miraculous when you consider it was built by people who think that chmod 755 is a perfectly reasonable way to say, make this file executable by everyone, but only writable by me. Huh? Well, let's take a high-level look at how Linux works, and we're going to talk about its different flavors and some popular Linux use cases. Linux was developed by Linus Torvalds in the early 1990s to be Unix-like, but free and open source. So, how does it work? Well, we start at the center of all of this with the hardware, the PC or the server or the embedded device that's going to run Linux. And then surrounding that hardware, that's where we add the Linux kernel. Now, the kernel speaks directly to the hardware. So, when an application wants to write a file or it wants to allocate memory, it asks the kernel. And the kernel that enforces access rules, it schedules processor time, manages memory, communicates with device drivers so the software doesn't need to know all the intimate details about every disk or network card or USB controller that's running in the hardware. And then surrounding the kernel, that's where we have all of the system libraries and where we put all of the utilities that are in a Linux distribution. Now, libraries such as the GNU C library, they provide building blocks for things like opening files or establishing network connections so that every application doesn't need to reinvent them. And low-level utilities like systemd, they start the machine, they launch background services that are called daemons, and they keep them healthy. And then above all of this lies the user space. So this is kind of the outer ring of Linux. And here's where you're going to find the command line shell, the graphical desktop environments like GNOME, and every application that you install. And each program runs its own process isolated by the kernel. And programs cooperate with each other through interfaces such as sockets, pipes, and shared files. Now, remember earlier I mentioned Linux distros because we're far too busy to say distribution. Well, you can't install Linux in the abstract. What you actually install is a Linux distribution. That's a fully integrated operating system assembled around the kernel. And while it's technically possible to compile the kernel and select the libraries and configure a package manager and wire up a bootloader and do all that stuff by hand, most of us prefer to start with a distribution that's been built, tested, and documented. And because use cases differ, well, so do distros. So let's consider a few of them. One distro, for example, is called Ubuntu. Now, that's maintained by Canonical and it's free to download. Ubuntu follows a six-month release cadence, and this frequent release schedule means that Ubuntu includes recent versions of compilers and language runtimes and drivers. And for that reason, it's often used for developer workstations and environments where staying current with software versions is prioritized. Now, compare that with a different distro, that's Red Hat Enterprise Linux or RHEL. RHEL is a subscription product. It's aimed at environments where predictability is really important, and each major release is supported for up to a decade, during which Red Hat actually backports critical patches without altering the application visible behavior of the core libraries. So RHEL is often the choice of, well, stateful databases and workloads governed by strict change management policies like banking and healthcare. And there are many other distros as well. For example, there's SUSE, there's Fedora, and a bunch more. And choosing the right one comes down to matching their release cadence, their support model, and their licensing to the risk profile of the workload that you plan to deploy. So where do people actually use this vowel-challenged operating system? Well, the answer is pretty much everywhere the computing happens. Now, Linux dominates the world of servers. According to W3Techs, Linux powers over half of all web servers on the internet. So chances are the last website you visited, probably running on a Linux server. And the Linux Foundation reports that it runs something like 90% of all cloud workloads. And that's partially because Linux's lightweight footprint means more virtual machines per physical server, and its remote management capabilities make it ideal for headless servers. And headless servers are systems without monitors or keyboards that are managed entirely through network connections. But it's not just servers. Linux has become the standard platform for software development and for DevOps workloads. So developers can use the command line tools, they can use the package managers that make dependency management at least bearable. And the fact is that most production servers run Linux anyway, so why not develop there as well? And DevOps teams use Linux for automation pipelines and container orchestration with tools like Kubernetes and infrastructure as code deployments. And then there's IoT, Internet of Things. Linux's modularity make it a really good choice for resource-constrained devices because there's just not a lot of room on your typical IoT device for a bloated OS. So you can strip everything out that you don't need and then create a minimal system that boots in seconds and it runs on limited memory. So that's why you'll find Linux in everything from smart thermometers to industrial control systems. And Linux is also the OS of choice when it comes to really large workloads in the form of supercomputers. Supercomputers run Linux because researchers can modify the kernel and the system software to squeeze out every bit of performance from their specific workloads. And the top 500 list of the world's fastest supercomputers is essentially a Linux showcase because every entry, 100% of them, run using a Linux kernel. So that's Linux. It's open source, it's adaptable to nearly any workload, and it's ruthlessly efficient. And I think it's also fair to say that if cutting syllables were a benchmark, Linux would top that chart too.